हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू ए टू जेड डेंटिस्ट्री एंड टुडे वी विल बी स्टडिंग अबाउट फेवरेबल एंड अनफेवरेबल फ्रैक्चर्स ऑफ एंगल ऑफ द मैंडिबल. सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड. सो बेसिकली दिस क्लासिफिकेशन दैट इज फेवरेबल एंड अनफेवरेबल इज गिवन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ डायरेक्शन ऑफ द फ्रैक्चर लाइन एज वेल एज द इफेक्ट ऑफ मसल एक्शन ऑन द फ्रैक्चर फ्रेगमेंट्स. नाउ दीज टू पैरामीटर्स आर वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एज वी नो दैट वेन एवर देर इज एन इम्पैक्ट on the mandible, right? So apart from the force of the impact and direction of the impact, the direction of fracture line will play an important role which will directly influence the favorability of the fracture. Apart from this, there are muscles attached to the mandible, especially muscles of mastication are attached on the mandible. Therefore, whenever there is an impact and there is discontinuity in the bone, right? So these muscles exert their respective actions on the mandible, which will directly affect the favorability of these fractures. So now let's try to understand what these words mean, that is, what is favorable and unfavorable. So basically, our mandible is surrounded by various muscles. It is completely covered by various muscles, and particularly when we talk about muscles of mastication, there are certain muscles which are known as jaw elevators, which are responsible for elevating or the upward movement of our jaw. And likewise, there are certain muscles which are referred to as jaw depressors, right, which are responsible for depressing our jaw or for the downward movement of our jaw. So in an event of trauma, what happens is that apart from the break in the continuity of the bone, there is direct trauma to the muscles, right? So these muscles exert certain action on the fragments of the bone. See, before fracture, our bone was functioning as a single unit, but after the impact, right, whenever a force is delivered, the bone breaks up into multiple pieces. So now these muscles of mastication play a very, very important role there, right? What they do is that some muscles will prevent these fragments of the bone from spreading apart, right, or from, you know, completely dislocating or displacing from their original position, and other muscles will tend to resist it, right? They will hold together all the broken fragments of the bone at one place. So depending upon this, we are classifying it as favorable or unfavorable, meaning that whenever our muscles will prevent, right, the displacement of the bony fragments, then we will classify such fracture as favorable. On the other hand, whenever this muscle pull will tend to displace those bony fragments away from each other or at a distant site, then we will classify a given fracture as unfavorable. So now let's begin with horizontally favorable fracture, right? So basically what this horizontally favorable means, that we are weaving this fracture line, right, from a given direction, that is, we are weaving it in a horizontal plane, and from this horizontal plane we are trying to classify this fracture as either favorable or unfavorable. So before getting into details of this, one must understand that our mandible is made up of multiple smaller units, right, that is the body, angle, coronoid, condyle, and so whenever an impact is delivered at the level of the angle of the mandible, it will tend to break the mandible mainly into two parts, right? One will be the body of the mandible and the other will be the ramus of the mandible. Now let's try to understand something about the muscle attachments. On the medial side at the angle of the mandible, right, we have the attachment of medial pterygoid, and on the condylar process we have the attachment of lateral pterygoid. Likewise, on the external surface or on the lateral surface, the angle area of the mandible is completely covered by masseter and the coronoid is covered by the temporalis muscle. So now let's move on to the fracture line, okay? So this fracture line basically passes from the alveolar margin downwards and forwards, okay? In the two figures, we can see the direction of the fracture line. So what happens is that the mandible is ultimately broken into two parts, as we have discussed previously. So now the displacement, okay, now in this case there would be an upward displacement of the which part? The proximal segment, right, which is the angle of the mandible along with the coronoid condylar process, right? So the upward displacement of this part
is prevented by the physical obstruction which would be caused by the body of the mandible itself. Now, we already know that we have muscle attachments here, right? Which I have told you previously. So, now particularly the muscles, that is masseter, temporalis and medial pterygoid, will tend to prevent this upward displacement. And therefore, this fracture would be called as an horizontal favorable fracture, right? So, moving on to horizontally unfavorable fractures. Now, in this case, the fracture line passes downwards and backwards. So, remember what we have studied previously in case of horizontally favorable fracture, that the fracture line passes downwards and forwards. Okay, now in this case, it is passing downwards and backwards. So, naturally, what would happen is that the upward displacement of our posterior segment would be unopposed, right? In the previous case, we had the body of the mandible which was preventing this upward movement, right? However, in this case, there is no physical obstruction and therefore we refer to this fracture as horizontally unfavorable fractures. Now, in some cases, what can happen is that this upward displacement might be prevented, especially when there is a presence of a tooth. So now when the particular tooth will contact its opposite tooth, then the upward displacement would be prevented. Another important thing with reference to horizontally unfavorable fracture is that which muscle is particularly responsible for this upward displacement. So mainly it is attributed to medial pterygoid. Okay, try to recollect what we have studied previously, that this medial pterygoid is a powerful jaw elevator, right? It is responsible for upward movement of our jaw and therefore also it is likewise responsible for the upward displacement which is particularly caused in this case. Okay, now for viewing these horizontal fractures, the best view would be lateral oblique view. Apart from this, we can also opt for a panoramic radiograph. Moving on to vertical fractures, right? Okay, so basically in this case, we are weaving the fracture line in a vertical plane, okay, that is in the buccolingual direction. So let's start with vertically favorable fractures. Now in this type of fracture, the fracture line passes from the outer plate, okay, or the buccal plate and passes obliquely backwards and lingually. Now fracture line in such a direction would tend to resist the muscle pull in the medial direction. Now in this case, we have to understand that this muscle pull is mainly due to two muscles, that is medial pterygoid and lateral pterygoid, because we are weaving this in a buccolingual plane. Now the muscle pull which is caused by the medial pterygoid and lateral pterygoid will prevent the medial displacement of the proximal segment here. So now moving on to vertically unfavorable fractures. Now in these type of fractures, the fracture line runs from inner lingual plate, passes obliquely backwards and buccally and results in medial displacement. Now try to recollect what we have studied previously in cases of vertically favorable fracture. There the fracture line was passing from the buccal or outer cortical plate and was going lingually, right? However, in this case, the line goes buccally. So this is very important because this direction of the fracture line basically decides whether a given fracture would be favorable or unfavorable. Now here there will be a medial displacement because of the action of the muscles, specifically the median and lateral pterygoid. Here the muscle pull will tend to displace the fracture segments away from each other. So in this figure, what we are able to see is the fracture involving the parasymphysis. Okay, now apart from our two important muscles, that is the medial pterygoid and lateral pterygoid, one more muscle will play a very important role in such kind of fractures, that is the genioglossus muscle. As we know that it is a muscle of the tongue, right? So these three muscles will be responsible for the displacement which would be caused in cases of parasymphysis fracture. And depending upon the direction of the fracture line and whether or not there would be any obstruction to the distal fragment, we can classify these fractures also accordingly as favorable or unfavorable fractures. Now let's move on to the clinical features. Okay, now on the extraoral examination, the most important or the most pathognomic sign which we can easily see is that there will be a bone tenderness, right? So now fracture in itself means that there is a discontinuity in the bone. So bone tenderness is very obvious sign and definitely there would be bone tenderness at the site of fracture. apart from it, if at all the fracture is displaced, right? So there will be a deformity, which is the step deformity. It will be palpable at the site of the fracture. Okay, now because the bone has been broken down into parts, so there will be a crepitus or a grating kind of noise at the site of fracture. So apart from all these signs, there are certain indirect signs which are present because of the injury or impact. These are swelling, ecchymosis, erythema, abrasion, lacerations, contusions. Okay, all these may be present. Now the lacerations or contusion in the region of the chin may be indicative of any symphyseal injury, right, which may or may not involve the condylar fracture. Apart from this, obviously there would be a facial deformity, and in many cases there would be an obvious facial deformity. Now this is because there has been a certain amount of displacement which is there. Okay, now the bone itself is displaced, so obviously we can appreciate facial deformity in such cases. In many cases we can appreciate an open bite. Okay, apart from it, certain fractures are also characterized by posterior cross bites. Also there would be an inability to occlude the teeth. Except for the fractures which involve the angle, ramus and condyle, all other mandibular fractures which are compound, right, meaning that the fractures which communicate with the external environment, right, are frequently characterized by blood stained saliva. Okay, now this saliva may be seen dribbling from the angle of the mouth. Okay, so these are certain external findings which we can appreciate in cases of these fractures. Now in this picture we can obviously appreciate the facial deformity. Now this is the case of a mandibular fracture which is displaced, right? That is, it is an unfavorable fracture. In the bottom images, the first image is indicative of anterior open bite, which is very common in case of bilateral condylar fractures. Also there is an OPG. Okay, now in this OPG we can appreciate the direction of the fracture line, and remember what I have told you, we take an OPG mainly when we have to study the fracture line in horizontal plane. So basically this is an example of an horizontally unfavorable fracture. So now let's move on to the features which will be seen when we undertake an intraoral examination. So obviously there will be some amount of lacerations, contusions and bleeding. Apart from it, there will be what we can say, certain blood clots or ecchymosis also may be visible. Now especially we have to examine for clots and ecchymosis in the region of buccal and the lingual sulci. Now there is a important sign which is known as Coleman's sign or sublingual hematoma, which is a clear cut indicator of mandibular fracture, especially the body fracture. Okay, so what is this Coleman's sign? So what happens is that if the periosteum, okay, now we know that our bone is covered by a layer of periosteum. Now in case there is an impact, there is a blow and the periosteum gets breached, okay, what will happen is that there will be a leakage of blood. Okay, as we know that periosteal is supplied by numerous periosteal vessels, so any damage to this lining will obviously cause a leakage of the blood into the surrounding tissue, particularly along the lingual side. Okay, now this blood tends to get accumulated here, and this is what constitutes our sublingual hematoma or the Coleman sign, which is visible at the region of the mucosa of the floor of the mouth. Okay, apart from it, step defects can be seen. There will be disturbances in occlusion. Anterior open bite, okay, is very common in such cases. Many lacerations can be seen. Apart from it, gingival tears are also common. Now in the first picture we can appreciate there is a buccal sulcal ecchymosis. Okay, and in the other picture what we can appreciate is the step deformity. There is loss of occlusion. Okay, now this loss of occlusion and anterior open bite can also be seen in cases of any parasymphysis fracture or in cases of symphysis fracture. So all these signs, whether they are extraoral or intraoral, should be carefully looked for, because certain signs are pathognomic for certain fractures, like Coleman's sign, indicative of fracture involving body of the mandible. Now apart from examining the mandible, we have to also take a look at our temporomandibular joint, okay? Because ultimately all the movements of the mandible are attributed to the TMJ. So we should look for any mobility of the fracture segments, or if at all our fracture involves bilateral condylar fracture, okay? Now, certain amount of mobility may be appreciated if at all there is a break in the continuity of the bone. Any pain, tenderness, or any crepitations, or any kind of deviation from the normal movements of the TMJ should be carefully looked for. We should never ignore any injury to the TMJ, especially if the patient is a younger patient, meaning that below the age of what we can say 10 or so on. Because if we don't examine the TMJ properly in such patients, then it may increase the chances of ankylosis. So always remember, whenever there is a fracture involving especially the mandible, we have to always examine for the TMJ. Moving on to the diagnostic part. So obviously this is a case of fracture, therefore we will be proceeding further with our preliminary examination, that would be our radiographic examination, right? So there are certain radiographic studies which are particularly helpful in cases of mandibular fractures. As we have already discussed previously, in cases of horizontal fractures, whether favorable or not, what we will take is that we will opt for an OPG or lateral oblique view. And in cases of vertical fracture, whether favorable or unfavorable, we will take an occlusal radiograph. So apart from it, there are certain other radiographs which can be taken, which are IOPA, that is intraoral periapical occlusal view, right? Obviously OPG, lateral oblique, PA view of mandible, reverse Townes projection. Now this reverse Townes projection is mainly taken for high condylar fractures, okay? Then TMJ tomograms can be taken. Apart from it, advanced diagnostic modalities such as CT scan is very helpful. Moving on to the last part, that is the treatment modalities which are available. So as for any fracture, we treat this fractures also by reduction, fixation and immobilization. So now, depending upon the type of fracture, age of the patient, several other factors, the reduction can either be an open reduction or a closed reduction. Likewise, we can either undertake a direct fixation or an indirect fixation. Now we will be talking about each of these in detail in my upcoming videos. So apart from it, our last step would always be immobilization. That is, we have to protect the part from any kind of movement for a certain period of time so as to ensure that our wound heals uneventfully, okay? Or in this case, the bone unites without any complication. So thank you for listening to me, and stay tuned for more such videos. Bye bye. See you in the next video.